Thank you all for being here on this wonderful warm day in Texas. Don't laugh,
It's too hot to laugh.
We are, you know, here we are in July, just a few months before we make our recommendations to the city. So I want to thank you all for all the work that you've been putting in, you know, to the task force and on your committees. And I know, you know, we're on the down end now, and so we appreciate all your time and effort and energy that you put into this committee and this task force. I'm going to ask my co-chairs if they have anything that they would like to share or say. Lily?
I just want to thank those of you who were able to join us over at the Country Club for the Women's Forum. I thought it really gave us still yet another audience to help with messaging. And those of you who weren't able to come, we felt you in spirit.
Yeah, obviously I think we're on the road now, so let's just do this thing.
The last meeting, you know, I was walking through the streets of Israel and trying to imagine what could be if everyone came together as one, as we're trying to do now. And when thinking about that, also this morning, a quote came across my mind by Van Gogh that says, "In the realm of ideas, everything depends on enthusiasm. In the real world, all rests on perseverance." So I thank you for persevering up until this point, and I thank you for your ideas, and I think if we put both together, enthusiasm, ideas, and perseverance, without doubt, we will be able to come up with recommendations that will bring peace, as I would hope one day in the Holy Land, brings peace to the Holy Land of Fort Worth. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Next on our agenda is the approval of minutes from our June 18th meeting. I hope you have all had a chance to review that. And we'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Ayes have it. I want to have two introductions of two individuals. As you know, we had a couple of people resign due to work and relocation and so forth. We also have just recently received Ratna Miles' resignation as well. We'll need to talk about that a little bit later on. But today we have Sarah Gillespie and Robert Monis that would like to say thank you for coming in on the, you know, here we are towards the end of the task force and the committee structure, but I know your willingness to participate and help in this endeavor because of the work that you all have done in the past as well to the city and to the communities that you live in. But Sarah, I'd like for you to say a few words about yourself.
I'm Sarah Gillespie. I'm a principal currently in Fort Worth ISD at Westcliff Elementary. I've been there for 13 years, and I've been with Fort Worth ISD for 16 years. I was the assistant principal at Ridgely Hills Elementary prior to that. And before that, I was the principal of a pre-K through 12 private school for 3 years, and then I taught secondary mostly, English, and a little elementary as well. So I'm just an educator. I live in Fort Worth, and I'm so honored to be here. I can hardly speak. I'm honored and nervous, and I'm just looking forward to learning and seeing all of you and contributing as much as I possibly can. So thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you.
Gilbert.
Yes, my name is Gilbert Mattis, and I by way of vocation, I'm a pastor of a church in the Riverside area, I'm in the Hospice and Church, and I'm also director of public relations for a hospice company that does business here in Puerto Rico and across the country. Great to be here. I have not been born here. I wasn't born before. I was born in San Antonio. My dad was a pastor, so I pretty much spent my pretty much a good part of my early life traveling. I finished basically my academic career here. in the best college ever, which is TCU. And that's just finished my master's degree at TCU. So that's been a real blessing in that process. I have two children, two recent grandchildren, one year and a half and the other 2 years. So that's been pretty interesting to go into the role of a grandfather. I'm still not adapting well, but I'm proceeding as best I can. But otherwise, I am real blessed to be a part of this. I've always been sort of a part of the city of Fort Worth anyway. While I was finishing up my doctorate, I did about 6 years in the housing department. So I had a good chance to see how the city operates, especially with the CDBG funding. And so it's been a real joy just to sort of go through this process and be a part of this as well. So thank you so much for the invitation.
Thank you. Welcome.
Welcome
to both of you. The next is an update on the work program for leadership training, ESTRAS.
I'm going to be very brief. What we discussed around the engagement practices for leaders with the community leaders and organizational leaders has now evolved in a good deal in response, Rosa, to your request to our council people. So we're crafting what will be a two-hour engagement training to each of the council's constituencies. So we're in the process of landing on dates, and I had some idea of what that would be like in the summer, and it's living up to it. But we're getting close, I think. So still good interest in it. And again, just designing kind of the core of what these all-day trainings have been, probably in a two-hour session. Some may be a little bit longer, but that's what we're going to be prepared to offer. So it looks like that will be mostly August.
Does anybody have any questions of ESTRAS? ESTRAS, do you want to elaborate a little bit about the districts that you're going to be doing training in?
Yeah. It's Council District 2. It'll be Council District 3, Council District 8, and 9.
2, 3, 8, 9.
2 is Carlos Flores. 3 is Brian Bird. 8 is Kelly Allen Gray. And 9 is Ann Zeta.
Just out of curiosity, were the districts picked, or the council members, were they volunteered to host, or was it just randomly?
They were volunteer. When we made our presentation to the council in early May, we had asked, because of the leadership training that was going on, we had asked any of the council members at that time if they would like to expand that training to the leadership of their community, their districts, that we'd be glad to share that information and participate and create some leadership programs for them. So that's where it came from.
This may seem like a dumb question, but did the ones that did volunteer, I don't know if they were in a group when they were asked, but did they know who did amongst themselves? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, because it was at the pre-council. Linda, is that been on disparities?
I didn't see her. As of last Friday, I did speak with Linda about the work being done by the National League of Cities. Contract with us, and NLC has not yet completed their work to our satisfaction. And Linda will be working with them to complete that assignment. And if they should fail to do so, then we will look to other ways of completing it.
Next, in front of you, you should have a copy of the draft. And this is to talk about the summary of committee recommendations. This is, of course, not all the substance that's going to go behind it, but this will give you an overview of what everybody is doing in each of their committees. But it'll also show you some overlaps of some, and specifically in economic development, when you see transportation, and of course the transportation committee is looking at, you know, transportation as well. So we will want you all to give a report, the chair of each of these committees, to give us a little little bit of tidbit of where you're looking at on these strategies. And of course, our recommendations or our draft recommendations would be completed, we hope, by August 3rd. We know that some of y'all are closer than others. I know for the Transportation Committee, we meet again this Thursday, and we'll be working on ours to pursue ours to have them completed by August 3rd. Fernando, would you like to add anything to that?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to be sure everyone's looking at the correct one-page summary. It has a green stripe across the top. It says draft discussion by task force members, and it has the date July 16th, 4 p.m. We were getting updates from various committees until around 4:30, actually.
That would be me.
So we would like for you to treat this one-page summary as just that. Behind each of these strategy recommendations is typically 2 pages of detailed information produced by each committee on the form that we distributed for your use. So I think it's important that we thank the committees for your hard work. An extraordinary amount of work has gone into these recommendations. They're not complete, and as we'll hear from the committee chairs, I think in some cases the work is 90% complete. In other cases, maybe a little less than that. But our aim is to get all of the committee reports submitted to us by August 3rd. That's a Friday. So that the following Monday, at the next meeting of the co-chairs will have the opportunity, at least at first glance, to review all the recommendations and begin determining what additional work remains to be done. So we want to thank the committees for your hard work. You will note that in addition to the 6 committees, criminal justice through transportation, we've also added a 7th item. And you'll recognize the specific topics associated with that 7th item because we've discussed them before. These are items that have not fit neatly under any of the 6 committees. And they happen to revolve around the topic of governance. They include, and we'll talk about these further, an independent citizen redistricting commission. This task force has discussed that idea at some length over the course of the past year. We've also talked about the effectiveness of the Human Relations Commission. And we talked, maybe less, but to some degree, about the mission of the Human Relations Unit. Angie Rush will talk with us further about that. The idea is that if you consider it appropriate, we'd like you to consider appointing a 7th committee that will detail these recommendations with support from Ms. Rush and her staff in the Human Relations Unit. So this afternoon, we'd like to spend the bulk of our time hearing from each committee about the status of the recommendations. Tell us essentially where you think this recommendation ought to be leading us, why you think it will address the identified disparities, how you think 5 years from now, if we implement the recommendation, we will have made measurable progress toward reducing or eliminating the identified disparities. This will give us an opportunity for all task force members, if they wish, to ask any questions that might be relevant. And the purpose of having everything on a one-page summary is to help you decide from a 30,000-foot level whether there are any major issues that we have, may have failed to capture in working through the committees. I know Rabbi Bloom has already asked some questions. Have we adequately addressed this topic or that? So this is an opportunity to ensure that we cover the waterfront on all the topics before we get further into the details of each individual recommendation. So thank you, Madam Chair.
Can I make a motion? Make a motion that we formally accept the addition of a 7th committee to the other 6 that we already have.
Is there any discussion on that? Anybody disagree?
Well, let's make a 2nd and then we can have a discussion.
2nd.
Okay. Now, is there any discussion on this? Because we had talked about these topics early on and we've talked about them throughout our meetings here. So, no question.
You know, I have a question and it's more so just to trying to jog my memory, the difference between the Human Relations Commission and the Human Relations Unit.
The Human Relations Commission is a citizens group appointed by the city council to provide the oversight of our work in enforcing civil rights laws and other efforts to promote community relations. The Human Relations Unit is the staff organization. It's a unit of the city manager's office.
Okay.
It's a staff to the Human Relations Commission.
So I'm familiar with the Human Relations Commission, but that was established almost 50 years.
Yes, that's correct, 50 right. years ago.
And so the, I hear it's on the unit. Kind
and of the unit up. Is the staff to the commission.
Gotcha.
So they go hand in hand. Auntie Rush is administrator of the Human Relations Unit, which supports the Human Relations Commission.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Yes, thanks for that question.
Yeah. Good question. Any other questions? All in favor?
Do we need to go into study?
We're good.
Anybody opposed?
Yes. That would be, it would be appropriate since you've just voted to create a new committee to appoint members of the task force to that committee and to select a chair of the committee. So that out.
Will you accept nominations?
That would be appropriate.
Right. I would, yes, we would take nominations, but I would recommend Charles Boswell to take the lead as chair because he knows the ins and outs of how the city works and is very familiar with these, all three of this, and plus he's the one that also brought the Independent Citizens Redistricting Commission to us. And made the presentation.
That was what I was
high five!
And if he's willing, I would recommend Gilbert to be on that.
I know I've said I've liked to work on that one too. So. But anybody that would like to volunteer to work on that committee, just send. You know, Fernando, an email, or just let us know before you leave here tonight that you're interested in serving, and that way we'll take those names down. Okay.
So we've got Mr. Boswell and Mr. Mattis.
Rabbi Bloom is going to be down there. Yeah. I'd like to also participate. Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, I would just say yes.
I got a little one.
It's even more of a reason to get on the committee.
Your wife has the little one.
Oh.
Oh.
I'm going to strike that guy.
But that's a blessing. Very blessed.
We don't have to make a decision today.
No. Okay. Just let us know because we've got only about 3 weeks to come up with the recommendations for this. So we'll start getting together. Take a look at it. Okay. So if you can let us know, say, by the end of this week. That way, give everybody a little bit of lead time. Cool. All right. Then let's go into our committee reports. Time.
Yes, and if I may, prior to going into our report, if I could add a strategy that I don't think I've captured from my comments. But it also has to do with the promotion of diversity within.
Ty, can you speak up, please?
Oh, okay. One thing that I would like to capture that I don't know if it's not captured on our paper, on this draft form, is the diversity within specialized units of the police department and the promotion and the diversity amongst the first level of promotion as well. If I may.
If I might just add something too for the new members, these committees came about as a result of the feedback we got from the community discussions. And so you may be wondering, how did we select these? We took all of that discussion and then created focus groups around them so we could get the biggest bang for the buck, if you will, out of those discussions. So that's how the committees came about.
Todd, anything else that you
want
to add?
Yes, and just to make sure that I apologize if I'm talking about it, but I want to make sure that I'm giving the task force the information that we need. But in this particular regard to strategies, are you more so asking why did we come up with these potential recommendations behind that strategy?
Yes.
Okay, just to make sure. With regards to strategy number one with the Citizens Review Board, in a lot of our tasks, in a lot of our town hall meetings, and individual conversations with people in the in the community, this has been a popular request to be made. There's a lot of data to support that. For I believe this, the task our committee believes that will support this. Fort Worth is the largest city in the state and maybe in the country that does not have a citizen review board. You bring in the arrest data to where 41% of African Americans make up the arrest in the city, but only make up the total population of 18%. A lot of citizens in the African American community believe that African Americans are being targeted. Citizens Review Board could create, help mend the relationships between law enforcement as well as the community, is our belief, and also reviewing what Dallas has done and what Austin has done with their Citizens Review Board. It's not been just kind of, it's fairly rarely used. I think Dallas, when we met with Dallas, I think they said they received maybe 12 complaints a year. And it's not more so to review officer discipline, but to allow citizens who may have a complaint that once they go through the complaint process, if they don't feel it resolved in the manner that they see fit, it gives them an opportunity to appeal to the Citizens Review Board that says, okay, well, I know that Internal Affairs said that the officer wasn't wrong or he wasn't rude to me, but I still feel like he was rude to me. And that, in which case, the Citizens Review Board would go back and make their recommendation. So, okay, in future purposes, you know, we think that this, you know, could have been handled a little bit differently, or maybe, you know, maybe review the policy a little bit different, but not actually, you know, they don't have access to that police officer who's subject of the complaint and things of that nature. And so some citizens review boards we looked at had subpoena power, some didn't. You know, and also that goes into whether or not the Fort Worth, the council and the mayor deems that that's appropriate or not. But based off the information that we have based from data as well as talking to people in the community, this is probably the number one thing that can come about from our committee.
So have you been able to research the pros and the cons of it, not just the pros of it, but also the cons? Because, you know, good, bad, or indifferent, not everybody jumps on board on a new strategic plan.
So. Right. I think a lot of the cons actually has come from, and I don't want to lump the whole PD, but some officers, under, I think, mistaken belief that it's going to be citizen policing officers. And I think it's more so not a citizen review board that's actually going to be, you know, critiquing officer punishment, but more so looking at civilian complaints. And so kind of how that works, and also with the meet and confer of the contract, whether or not it's something that would have to be negotiated into the meet and confer contract, or if it's a provision that the city can move forward without without the officers, the POA agreeing to it, has been a con as well. And some people believe that it's not necessary, that we're going to make a big change in implementation, but because of a few, you know, isolated incidents, that we're making wholesale changes. So that's been kind of pushbacks and some cons to where are we being too, you know, we're being too overcorrecting for the, you know, the Jack and Craig incident on making wholesale changes with the Citizens Review Board. And Corey and Bishop Kirkland, feel free to jump in on what pros and cons we've heard.
I haven't heard. The cons I've heard have been from people who have been convicted, who have a problem with the city and feel like they were wrong, or family members feel like they were wrong. And I don't think it would be counter. It would be a conjunction with the police department. It's not to critique, it is just an avenue for the citizens to go, because when that door is shut by the police department, they said the investigation's closed. Some of them feel like they didn't get their portion heard fully. So I hadn't really heard anything bad, and that's when the other two, the Police Officers Association, they were here, and I asked them point blank, do you have a problem with that? And both of them said no.
No, Nestor said that he would like to have some training for those individuals.
Yes,
to serve.
Yes. And the people that would be on there, and one of the best things, I think every person here just go to the police academy and go through that training, because it'll open up your eyes and give you a different perspective if you have one, because, I mean, they have a top-notch facility down there on training and some of the things that they do, so we were very impressed. I took my son and one of his friends down there with them, one of these police officers, like my wife, so it's very informative.
And I don't know if this might be trying to, leave my attorney hat on. And in our recommendations, I was thinking about when we submitted, give different cities what they're doing with their citizen review board, and we'll say, okay, this is what they're doing. Not, if we need to propose legislation of what it looks like, or I'll leave that to the petition to do. But if that's necessary on what, seeing what other cities are doing, comparable sizes or other size municipalities, kind of what they're doing, and allowing the council and the mayor to say, okay, well, this is what everyone else is doing and structuring how they see fit, but this is the recommendation that we think is necessary.
Because we just want to make sure it's data driven.
I think more importantly, if you could put together a couple of examples of the types of cases that they review, and if you look at the mission statement, one of the words in the mission statement is to listen. So it fits very well within what we set up at the very beginning. So it gives us another listening mechanism, is what I'm hearing. And I agree. I think that people sometimes want just another way of expressing themselves. And I don't know if the structure, the formal structure and feedback that we would get from it, but formal, in terms of formal appeal power and all that. But just to be heard sometimes what people feel valued over is just to be heard. So I think that recommendation would fit very well with our mission statement.
I kind of want to do strategy number two and number three together, because they kind of go hand in hand. The police cadet program was mainly geared for what to do with our potential officers that recruits who are 18 to 20 who don't quite meet the eligibility to actually go through the academy. And talking from various officers within the PD is that that program was very helpful to keeping homegrown talent within the Fort Worth. It's a lot harder nowadays to keep, but millennials, between the younger millennials, between 18 to 20 engaged and trying to keep them interested in going into law enforcement. And that program helped build that gap on kind of filling their time before they're eligible to go into the academy as well. And then also can actually help with number three, with the recruitment. Under Chief Windham in the 80s, there was a 30% minority representation of law enforcement, which a lot of came from homegrown Fort Worth, Tarrant County residents. And now the demographic is down to roughly, I don't have the numbers on top of me, but I want to say 14% African Americans and about 18% Hispanics, I believe, in the PD. And a lot of the minority, particularly African American recruits, aren't coming from Fort Worth. They're coming from more of the targeted recruiting efforts on the East Coast, from the historical black colleges and universities. But the cadet program, if we, put the resources back within our city, we can also have officers back patrolling those communities to where they can run from. I know we have the information from the previous cadet program, what they had. I know they have the Fort Worth Explorer program that has a lot of diversity within that program, but it's geared towards more so teenagers and not so much. You have a few more years before they're actually eligible to, they have the same problem, say, 18, 19, 20, for, what to do to kill that boy. And so, and also, talking with the recruitment, I believe it was two officers that do all the recruitment for the entire PD. And if you're going to be intentional, if you're going to, two people in a PD that has over 1,000 plus officers doing recruitment and expecting to go to Philadelphia, New York, Houston, various schools to do recruitment, how effective can we be? We sat down, we met with them. I believe they're doing a lot of good efforts to try to recruit African Americans, Hispanics, Asians, males, females, but I don't think they have enough resources being put behind them to actually do an effective job. I'm gonna turn the cord
Bishop Kirkland, feel free to jump in on that, but that's kind of what some of the data has shown us about, but which also goes into number four as well, if that makes sense.
So would this be a police cadet, would this be a cadet program, or are you proposing to grow your own?
No, it's a cadet program. Fort Worth PD had a cadet program for a while. It's not unusual. I believe Euless PD utilizes the cadet program. Our own Symphony has a cadet program. So it's something that was actually within Fort Worth that was funded by the city, but they just defunded that program. So it's almost just re-implementing that cadet program. And going into number four that I just added about the diversity and the specialized divisions and the first promotional level, there's just not a lot of the pool to actually pull from. There's not that many. I forget the numbers off the top of my head, but I want to say there's less than 100 African-American detectives within the whole PD. And there's roughly 19 specialized divisions, and some of those divisions go unfilled by African Americans. One, because the pool's not big enough, but also a lot of...
What's the Hispanic number?
It's a little bit more. They're just for the...
And the promotions, is that what you're struggling with?
Both. Assignments.
Assignments
and promotions. Hispanics are more because they have a bigger population. 14% of our PD, I think, is African American. About 20% is Hispanic.
Are there any Asians or other ethnicity groups?
There's about a handful of Asians within specialized.
I think about 1%. Just about 1% of them.
I just think it's important for us to make sure that we notate all the numbers of each minority group.
We have all.
I'm not trying to be angry or anything, but sometimes when we talk about one race only, and we need to talk about all races.
And I apologize if it seems like I'm only geared towards African Americans. That's not at all
the indication.
And I have the breakdown of all the numbers. Just don't have it memorized on top of me, but the numbers are supported by the data, what they show.
Because I think we need to show this council and the mayor the diversity of how the future of this city is going to look like. Good, bad, and different. I mean, we're going to be a very diverse city, not just blacks and Hispanics, but there's other groups that are here. In fact, I was walking in today, and there was another Middle Eastern family walking in, and they just started talking to me, asking me questions about the Botanic Gardens, and I was like, well, I don't work here, but okay. So I answered questions. But I started thinking about them and started thinking, you know, we've got a huge population that's coming in and moving in here, so we've got to think forward as well.
And I want to make sure I point this out too as well. The last five police academies that have gone through the police academy, they have been more diverse to more reflect the city of Fort Worth population. However, you don't see, you know, if a recruit goes through the system, it's going to basically, when I say the system, through the police academy, through the field training process. It's almost a two-year process before you actually see them by themselves in the streets. And so, you know, when we had the opportunity to review the diversity breakdown for the last five classes, it's more in line with the numbers that we have in the city. So I will say the PD has, you know, been intentional, you know, dating back to, I want to say, the last class of 2016 up to present, of trying to be more diverse, but it just takes longer before we see it.
Yeah, it takes time.
And just talking to the officers who are out recruiting, the ones who are just out the field trying to get people in, it seemed like they just were having a hard time getting people, period. White, Hispanic, that want to be a police officer, so it's not like they're not trying. In my opinion, they are trying. And one of the portion on here that we didn't get to is going to be the municipal courts because of the marshal service, which they have some issues there, some major issues. And like I was telling most citizens, their first encounter with, or only encounters with the city is, I go to the park or the swimming pool, I pay my water bill, and I go to the municipal court. That's most citizens encounter with their city. And just the attitude that's at the municipal court is horrendous from the judges that I have seen in there, making fun of one gentleman's weight, unacceptable. Another judge talking to a prosecutor, no decorum in the courtroom, court number 4. And I talked with the administrator when I was there, taking care of a citation. This was part 2. It was dismissed. But when I told the judge who was there that she was ignorant of the law, she said, "You're trying to get me to dismiss this ticket, Mr. Session. I know what you're trying." I said, "No, I'm trying to get you to do a continuous because the prosecutor who's supposed to be here is not here. That's not my fault." Prosecutor asked me to come outside. Said, "Mr. Session, let me talk to you outside." Before we walk outside, the bailiff gets the paperwork from the judge, and we're as close as the three of us. And he tells the prosecutor, "This is a waste of time." I said, "Excuse me? It's a waste of whose time? Your job? Whose time is it a waste of?" And they ushered me out into the hallway. I just happened to have Ms. Ewing's phone number, and I called her. She came down and told me that they were making corrections from the previous complaint of sending people home because one particular bailiff didn't like how they were dressed. They never got to make their announcement in court, and she said, "Baby, you need to go home and learn how to dress. Here's our dress code." Those people had negative appears, warrants put out for them. She came down to tell me about that, and I said, "Well, that's great. I'm glad you're making some changes. However, this just happened." And the prosecutor verified that the bailiff said it. Yes, he did say it. That's unacceptable. Every citizen doesn't have Ms. Ewing's phone number.
So you are adding municipal courts as strategy 5?
Oh, yeah. We're meeting with municipal services and those representatives on the 31st.
All right, so we'll add that on here for that strategy.
Okay. I'd just like to add one thing to the specialized units issue. And I said this to you the other day, and I was told that I'd misheard things, but I don't mishear very often. We were told why, when we asked, why aren't there more minorities in these specialized units, that they just don't want the job. They don't want to work long hours. They don't want to be on call 24 hours a day, which did not make sense to me. That needs to be addressed. Because when I asked the chief why, he said, "Well, maybe it's our policies." And I asked, "Who sets the policy?" So if there are policy issues that need to be addressed in that, we need to point that out to them, because...
So one thing we've heard regarding the promotion, that's a civil service standardized test that the chief has to have, hasn't had to do with that as well. So, you know, as far as the policies, as far as how they, from my understanding how promotion, they take the six top test scores.
To captain, it's based on testing. Then at captain level, I think there's an assessment that goes with the testing. So it's the testing plus the assessment. And then at major, deputy chief are all appointed positions that the chief can appoint whenever he wants to.
Do you have any comments?
Well, I mean, our testing process, especially for the beginning, what you're talking about, our police officers have to be certified police officers on their own for 4 years before they can take that initial test. So, I mean, that's a requirement that is in our contract, and each subsequent test after that, there's a 3-year requirement in that year in rank to be able to take the next test above that. So, yes, you are correct. It is civil service. It is basically you give a list of study materials, they study it, they go take the test, and usually, as long as they don't have an internal affairs history or any issues that would prevent them from getting promoted, they get promoted basically on the rank of how they scored on the test.
And, Barbara, one thing I want to add too is that we've had the opportunity to talk to a lot of different officers, and, one thing that I can say that it made sense to me
why some minority officers weren't taking the test. It's because they actually lose money when they go into the specialized divisions because they can't work their part-time jobs. A lot of officers say they rather have the opportunity to do their, you know, their shifts and then maybe their part-time to where they're making a couple extra $100 at night. Not saying that that it excuses why we don't have, why there's not minorities promoted within, but that was something that we heard about.
And that was captured in the minutes for this from the last meeting too. So yeah.
So how do we get there? What's the recommendation going to be?
You know, I think it could be as simple as senior officers is just encouraging minority officers to take the test. And, you know.
Is there a pay problem?
I think there's always going to be, you know, a pay problem, pay issue involved. But, you know, I always misquote how my dad says, you know, can you want to. You know, yeah. So if a person doesn't want to further their career, their consideration, the police officer, there's nothing to do that chief officer all the way down is going to be able to do that first. Or there's not going to be enough incentives in place. I know the incentives to be a field training officer comes down to, you know, you can correct me if I'm wrong, maybe $10,000 stipend or additional.
It's 10% more.
Yeah, 10% more. So, and you're taking on a lot more work. So some want to know if it's actually worth going through the additional police academy training and taking on another officer for an additional maybe $5,000 before taxes.
Charles?
I may be wrong, but I think this possibility we're confusing a couple of different things. One is just the promotion, yes, based on written test. But, okay, so you've taken your test, now you're a sergeant, right? You've got sergeants in patrol,
yes,
you've got sergeants in SWAT, you've got sergeants in homicide. We're talking about we don't have any minorities in some of these specialized units, regardless of their rank. And I don't know what it's all at play with that, but it's more than just failure to take a promotional test, I think.
So there's not the amount of spots there is for the specialized divisions, there's not enough minority officers, I think, that are qualified for those positions.
Is it enough for us as a task force to say to the city council, we think this is an important initiative to create diversity within these specialized units, and you figure it out, or you tell the chief to figure it out, but it's just not acceptable to not have any African Americans in the homicide, you know?
It's why. I think the expectation would be that this task force would work with the police department to figure out how to get it done. I think we need to be specific and practical in our recommendations and complete. I don't think it's going to fly to say you figure it out.
You figure it out, yeah.
Because that, for one thing, that's going to make it easy to ignore.
Right.
I think if
well, you say, yeah, I was, that was a little flip, but to, yeah. To say commit to a strategy. By the date certain of how we're going to do this.
Yeah, I would suggest that we commit to a certain number or a certain percent. So X numbers be hired or coached and mentored into these positions by this date, by the end of year one, and a certain percentage of it. I think we have to be real specific and there will be no movement. They call out a number.
But we also need to make sure that they meet all the requirements.
They're not going to get permitted. I don't think they'll get promoted.
But if you're saying to meet within a year, do we have anybody that can step into that role?
But they have to prepare them to do that.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. And I agree with you, okay? Do we have any that are ready to be trained to do that? Or do we have to train them before we can put them in there?
They can hire them. They can even hire them in as new people. They don't have to go up. They could be hired. I think we give them a number and say, this is our recommendation. We want to see all of these facial things diversified and inclusive here, and we want to see it by this time. We recommend you get it done because this is where all the problems are coming from.
they can't see themselves and the people they're beating up on.
I think we're at a disaster. As we're going around the well to get the water, I think we need to go to the well to get the water. And in that sense, I think maybe in terms of success, we need to be with the BPA. We need to hear from them specifically and what their opinion is, what it is. I don't.
You know, and I know they came to the last meeting, but it goes without being said that we've invited BPA, the Latino officers, and the POA to come to multiple committee meetings, and multiple emails have not been responded to, or we'd rather come together. So it's not been for lack of effort, lack of trying, but I think that you can't have an effective conversation with the respective organizations as a collective. I think that the best way for us to get real data, real information, real, was to sit down with them individually.
You can make a request to those associations to almost, I don't say mandatory, but if we're trying to get information and make progress and this is a holdup.
Well, I would say Chief Krause even sent emails on behalf as well to try to make it happen. You can't force private organizations to
want to be. I'm going to give them a try.
Chief, do you have any suggestions to help us to accomplish that?
Well, I got a comment first because Mr. Boswell is absolutely right. We're talking about two different issues here. One is a promotional track. One is an actual filling specialized units with a diverse group of people. They're apples and oranges, different away from each other. So the promotional track is pretty well set. Yes, we can encourage people to take the test. If they meet the certain guidelines and criteria, yes, they can take the test. However, the other one I think is a little bit more important that we need to kind of address. So historically, about 10 years ago, if we would have had, let's say, an opening in homicide, I guarantee you would have probably 10 to 15 detectives put into that position. Today, you do the same thing, you have less than probably 3 to 5. That's historically across the department, every unit, doesn't matter what it is. If you want to talk about SWAT historically, 10 years ago, would have 50, 60 people put in for positions that maybe we only had 1 or 2. Today, we have less than 15. Why is that? It's a generational deal.
Right.
It really is. And it doesn't matter the color, it doesn't matter the race.
That's exactly what it doesn't matter.
It just comes across that generationally, people like SWAT, for example, they really do work a lot of hours. They do. I mean, they're on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. There are only 4 people that can be off at any given time. So, I mean, some people don't want to do that. And it does restrict some of their part-time jobs if they do work part-time jobs.
And I'm glad you brought that up because, you know, Chief Krause let us know that it was a homicide position that came up and only 2 people applied for it.
Yes.
And you know, what we've also discussed in our individual committee meetings is that, you know, you can't really quantify it with data, but social media has turned off a lot of people from wanting to be
Absolutely.
In police officers. That just, you know, I think that goes to the recruitment aspect of it as well. So, and I think it's absolutely right. You know, if we can work on getting to that first level of promotion, but in order to get to the specialized, people just, you know, you're really committing yourself a lot more than what you are if you just want, you know, a police officer. But I don't think that we should still not try to have some type of, you know, recommendation in place to improve, even if it means, okay, just one minority in each division, you know, or something along those lines. But it is, it's I think it's generational, exactly like you're saying.
Now, one of the things that we have done, and I don't know if Chief Krause might have said this, if I did, I apologize if you've already heard it. I mean, we've actually created open houses kind of concept to let people come in to see what they're in store for if they come to the unit, maybe entice them to come in. We've invited a multitude of people to come through whenever we've had openings. I mean, I can't force somebody to go, but I can invite them. But if they choose not to come, it's the same thing if I have the opening. If they choose not to come in, I can't put in for them, you know, because it's an internal paternal drive for somebody to want to be in that position. So, I mean, I'd be very cautious about trying to force people in positions they don't want to be in. So just recently, you know, we had an opening for the narcotics sergeant position. Historically, that's a very coveted position within our department. 4 people put in. 4. You know, and it's it's hard for us as supervisors or executive staff members to try and create a diverse pool whenever we don't have a diverse pool that actually is put in. So, you know, we do our best with the people that we have, and I can promise you, at least from my level and above and below, we do our darndest to try and get the best applicants we can for those positions. And we go out and we actually recruit for the diversity within those units because we know that they're lacking. But we're also fighting against ourselves as well. So you have a very great candidate that, you know, maybe African American, maybe Hispanic, maybe Asian. Well, other units are also vying for that same person. And so whenever they take a test and they promote, well, guess what? They're now at a different level, and we're fighting for that same pool of applicants like everybody else. And it's no different than when we're recruiting police officers. Every agency around the Metroplex is fighting for the same top candidates, and so the pool gets drained very quickly.
So Jennifer, you had a question.
Yeah, so one of the questions that you're kind of highlighting that I asked last time when we had the representatives from the officer associations was around the actual jobs themselves, and you're also speaking to that as in some ways. Does the city of Fort Worth need to look at changing, redesigning jobs when we're talking about the police? I know that all of you, for example, healthcare's changed, journalism's changed. It's not like it is was when you first started. I know that some of these fields, police, fire, et cetera, are very structured, but perhaps based on the generational forces, the employment rates and everything that they are, we're competing for talent and homegrown talent, like you're saying, Ty. Is that something that somehow has to be interwoven into our recommendations that we look at redesigning the jobs? If Fort Worth is leading the way of policing in a different way, the police job looks different, so it's more appealing to younger generations that want that work-life balance. Just throwing it out there, I don't know.
And I don't know if my response is going to, you know, capture what you're saying, but I know we can redefine things, but I think ultimately there's still TCOL requirements that every police officer has to meet, and that's the bare minimum. I know there's different. I wish that everyone could get all the information that we have within our committee, but Chief Fitzgerald and the different type of training that they've implemented in the academy, I think it's more relevant to today's issues, implicit bias training and things, different things of that nature. But as far as how you make being a police officer cool again, if you will, that's to their marketing department. And you know, I guess the lip sync battles aren't working.
They're fun to watch.
Okay, I'm going to wrap up this one because we've already talked almost over 30 minutes just on this one category, and we've not hit all the other committees yet. So we may be here till 9 if all of them take a little over 30 minutes. But does anybody have any other questions?
I guess I wonder, what is it going to look like then when you finish? Are we going to suggest that they reevaluate? Or I'm not sure where we're going with that one. So next Monday when we meet, I'm not really sure where we are. We have to diversify that group. So how do we get there?
This particular, and I won't take too much time, that particular area for how to effectively work that recommendation, it's been a battle. Because, and I think, you know, it's almost like I left it off the email on Fernando, because how do you kind of capture that strategy or make the effective recommendation? Because the part of it is you have to have willing individuals that want to do it, but also there's a need for it as well. So trying to capture this kind of been a challenge.
I like the idea of creating something different. You know, and you're right, in healthcare things have changed. But what you have to know is that your community is changing as well. So how do you structure something where people are pushing themselves in rather than you trying to pull them in? How do we, what kind of strategic plan can be put in place to change the way people see that? I think that's what we have to do. That's what we had to do in nursing. And now there are waiting lists for nurses.
And when we talk about, I think, minority recruitment, we're talking also about every race. We're talking about gender as well.
Right.
That's what we look at.
And we need to make sure that our remarks state that. Next on the list is Charles on economic development.
Yes. First of all, I'd like to give thanks to the staff, to Michelle and Barbara Stearns, especially for the excellent support they provided in this. So you'll see here we have five broad categories of strategies: job training, transportation, the hiring process, our incentives policy, and the capacity building for minority-owned businesses. These relate directly to the three categories of disparities that were in our bailiwick, which related to income, wealth, employment, unemployment, and then to the number and size of minority businesses in Fort Worth vis-a-vis other large cities in the state of Texas. So beneath these five strategies, there are a host of detailed objectives or initiatives. In job training, we would be looking at working with our various partners, ranging from workforce, TCC, our various school districts, and the preparation, targeting job fairs. And a lot of our committee discussion was about connecting or focusing on areas of the city which have higher unemployment, which have higher minority populations, to make sure those job fairs are reaching that population. Transportation is not...
Can I ask you a question? I'm sorry. When you're talking about job training, you're talking about job fairs is one thing. Are you talking also about, because it could go in education, like technical school training?
Yes.
So that will be under there as one of them?
Yes. Okay. We've had a comment made. Terry, you know, who was on our committee, was very resourceful. Her observation was that Fort Worth ISD lags behind some of the other school districts in terms of career and technological preparation.
Absolutely.
And so I think, while that's not a per se a city of Fort Worth responsibility, I think we need to work together with our school district to beat that up. But yes, that would be primary. And looking at the future for what careers are going to be in demand and trying to encourage kids to go that way. On the second one, on transportation, that's not really dealing with the overall mobility needs of the population, but really how you connect people who need jobs to where the jobs are. And so that may mean some special initiatives with the Transportation Authority. It might mean working with major employers, Chamber of Commerce perhaps, to establish linkages to get people to a job site. You know, we know that there's an awful lot of job creation, for example, up in the Alliance Corridor, which is not adjacent to where our pockets of poverty and unemployment are. So there's a disconnect here. And this is not breaking news, but we need to think about, reimagine how we can get people from one place to another in terms of job opportunities. Hiring process, both our committee and housing talked a lot about the whole ban the box idea. That you know, we put so, as a society, we put so many barriers to people that if you have a criminal record, you can't rent an apartment, can't get a job. This is just trying to say, rather than immediately screen people out, if we could voluntarily get people to adopt a ban the box idea on application forms, maybe you get a little bit farther down the road where you can be evaluated on your merits and not have a criminal history. Fernando and I have had a discussion on the same line. If you follow football, you know the NFL, the Rooney rule, which is on every head coaching vacancy, the team is required to interview at least one minority applicant. What if that were true in the city of Fort Worth and with all executive positions that came open. We can't pass a law to do that, but if we could foster a culture that embraced that philosophy. Again, this would be working with our corporate leaders, chambers of commerce, and so forth to adopt that kind of thing. Anyway, that gets into the hiring process. We want to stop people from being screened out. The discussion we've had is some people, employers have gone to a system where they don't really focus on the name. Again, that's a way people can get screened out, but kind of do it more anonymously until you get down to the final hiring decision. So, some ideas there. Incentives policy, when the city does economic incentives, tax abatements or rebates to foster development, structuring those incentives so that if you were locating your project in a high need area, you can qualify for higher incentives. If you're going into Southeast Fort Worth, have a higher degree of incentive provided than if you're going to the aforementioned Alliance Corridor, for example. Also in this, incentivizing higher paying wages, jobs that command a higher wage that actually lift people out of poverty. So that's part of what we mean in the incentives policy. The capacity building for minority owned businesses, there's an exciting initiative that the staff was already pushing forward, which is a mentor protege program. And we may talk about that some here, but that would be taking a successful company, pairing them with a new, perhaps minority business that would benefit from the experience of building more established company. I think that has a lot of promise. Also here would be re-examining, reinvigorating the city's relationship with the Hispanic Chamber and the Black Chamber, and how we can make those partnerships yield greater benefits.
I have a couple of questions. On the job training, the Fort Worth ISD, I just thought about it. Do they do like job fairs at high schools? I'm just saying, is that an idea? I don't know if they
yes,
do.
Yes,
do they do that?
Yes.
And the transportation part?
The big hiring events. They do college fairs.
But they do do a job fair. It's great. Because we were just
talking about at the different high schools.
No, that they do one collective big job fair for, especially for the kids who are graduating or looking for summer to work and so forth. I forgot what her name is, but she's been doing it for years.
But that's going, the kids have to go there, but can the job fair come to the school?
Some of the schools do that.
And on the transportation portion, they come in, y'all talk to the teachers before the transportation authority. One thing I would suggest, when I was in college in Austin, you could come from far south Austin all the way up to the technology corridor, Round Rock. The buses, an express bus. It started here and it didn't stop when you got there. If they have anything on track to do that, coming from Stop 6, coming from South Crowley, that would take you. You want to work at Amazon? Can catch a bus that won't stop until it gets there.
That's kind of thing.
Any questions?
On the transportation too, we were talking about not just those expresses, but then once you get to Alliance, how do you move people in that area? Like what kind of circulators need to be in place to take people from what would be a transit hub to some of these businesses? We actually had a business come to City Council that spoke, and they actually pick up people and take them to work
like
because
the
transportation was an
when
issue.
They go, got a free ride to your job.
And there's a parking lot right over there in the Alliance area that the team put together many years ago.
So there's been a lot of work on that, but not on that. It's actually a hub point.
I promise you.
Oh, yeah. Anything else of Charles?
I'm just curious, that some of those people that need those services, that do they understand, because I think a lot of times, when people have transportation issues and Fort Worth isn't that great to be such a major city, is that do people know that once they catch these buses to get them to the side of town, that there are other avenues to get them directly to those places? Are we doing a good job, or is the city doing a good job, the people know that, hey, you're not worried about getting well on the side of town, once you're there, it's just available.
I don't know if that's exactly what you're saying, but we have a lot of customers who will get to, you know, one spot, and then they'll take Uber somewhere else because the bus or whatever ride they were, like say they were counting on a neighbor. Is that what you were?
No.
No.
Okay. You really guys understand anymore?
This is city telling people,
right?
Hey,
right. The people.
You can get this job at Amazon. Don't
right.
Pick, but we got to have an express bus to go or something to go from south southern sector to the northern sector. But is Amazon providing shuttle service to their campus from the hub? And are we asking Amazon type businesses, hey, we can get your employees because they're always hiring, but you got to get them from here to there. Bell Helicopter did it many years ago.
Right.
And it is the Amazons and the UPS that have the largest number of a pool of people coming at the same time. They're the ones who are chipping in. But what you just said, is the city asking that? That's actually, I think, embedded in this. We need to have more of those discussions when they are bringing companies in.
And is the city communicating that to prospective people looking for a job?
Right,
is the city telling, hey, job fair, if you want to work at Amazon, we can get you there and they will pick you up. You don't need a car. I mean,
we do that. I mean, we let them know when there's transportation to a company or not. But again, there's
limited individuals that are doing it.
Yes.
So not every company is doing it. There's limited individual companies that are providing those services.
Sometimes when you get out there, you're still 2 miles away from where you got to go.
Right. And that's what she was saying, that they would call Uber or something to pick them up and drop them off. So there's still a lot to do from the first mile to the last mile.
Thank Captain, what you were thinking, Bishop?
I just told my neighbor, to be a preacher, I'm not articulating very well, and that's not a good thing.
But I don't know what the city tells them. I mean, I know as someone responsible for a candidate.
So, as your committee, have you guys entertained the idea that, hey, we need to do more or better, there has to be a better way of letting potential applicants know? Because I could want to work at Amazon, and when I look at it's in that quarter, I say, there's no way I can get there. I turn the page. But that if I'm looking at this simultaneously, if I'm looking at, hey, that there are some of these jobs, whomever they be, that will provide additional transportation once I get to this side.
I think you're talking about PR and outreach.
Yes, sir. Thank you, preacher to preacher.
Actually, that's one of the things the Transportation Committee discussed, is that the city needs to be more involved in PR and outreach for transportation.
Yes.
Thank you. That's what I was.
Okay. Anything else for Charles? Bob.
So for education, we're very grateful to have Gilbert and Sarah join our committee, and we are also incredibly grateful for Dr. Robinson and Maya's support. It's been invaluable. We have three strategies that we are working towards fulfilling and being able to present. Dr. Masic, who has left for another opportunity, is working on really formulating the early childhood education strategy, and that's something that we've talked about at length, and she has agreed that she will still articulate and get in writing the strategies and the challenges, etc. But we feel strongly that the investment into early childhood education and giving those students the best possible opportunity to be ready to learn when they get into kindergarten is the best investment that we as a community can make so that they are on the right path. And that involves certainly providing opportunities for the parents to become that child's best educator, and inspiring them to find value in education. It also is about making sure that there are opportunities in the existing pre-K programs within community schools or transportation to those schools that do have opportunity, and also opportunities for those educators to continue to grow as educators, have opportunities to grow both economically and educationally, so they have incentives to continue to stay in early childhood education. We're meeting tomorrow, and hopefully we'll work on, again, moving that a little farther forward. Arturo, who unfortunately just left, really was our lead on our second strategy, which is the career and college and career readiness. And we spent a good amount of time going through this at our last committee meeting. The disparities that this really addresses is the high school dropout, the lack of preparedness for college and career, and the lack of civic involvement. And this strategy involves high quality civic engagement. And it really leans on the research that talks about how civic engagement generates positive outcomes, both academically, civically, and ultimately results in better economic and employment opportunities for the participants, which obviously helps elevate the community. So actions that would support this particular strategy for pre-K would be investing in out-of-school time learning, summer-type opportunities. All of these are leveraging many existing programs that already exist. Actions for higher education are really following the models of the GO centers for the ISD and also the TCC use. And then joint strategic actions for pre-K higher education community organizations involve engagement with intercultural networks and other civic organizations to assess both learning opportunities and grow the impact. That would engage, TCC would be a primary partner within that. That's something they're doing a lot of. It would also be able to involve a lot of businesses and civic organizations to work on as well. The third strategy is...
Bob, can I go back to the second strategy for a second? Well, you know, I personally think college is important. It's definitely not the only path towards making a decent living. I think someone who goes into plumbing is more likely to do better than someone who's going to study philosophy, and definitely not in the same amount of debt. Are you looking at, or are you suggesting, once again, there's a connection with the economic, the technical schools? I don't think we as a society, one, respect enough someone who's going to be a plumber or HVAC or anything like that. We have a tendency just to say someone went to college and that's that. Maybe it's important that we really try and put emphasis on there, not only in the schools, but in the city of saying, you know, I just think we're doing a disservice to our students if we're only pushing college, AP class.
No, we had a big conversation about meeting with major employers and trying to understand the skill sets that they are going to need both today and tomorrow, and making sure that training for those trades are a big part of it.
Good. Absolutely. Good.
The third one is to leverage somewhat what the data dashboard on Reforth Worth provides as far as an online education mainstream or resource. There are a lot of, this goes back to the last conversation about marketing and outreach. There are a lot of great things available to folks in the community, but many of them don't know. And so a lot of it is going to be a combined effort, I think, between both having a online resource center where folks can find that information, but we've also talked about the idea of having a community liaisons or advocates within the various communities that could do outreach, that could work from these GO centers or from community centers and make sure people knew the available resources and opportunities that were available. And this is what we're going to talk primarily, I think, at our meeting tomorrow. And I don't know, Maya, if you want to add something to that.
Any questions of Bob?
I'm going to have to leave at right at 6:30, but I'm going to go ahead and get started, and I'm going to ask Miriam to kind of follow up because I was not able to make our last meeting because that's when a certain gentleman was here and Luzon's office was moving around like a little scared, whatever. But for the health committee education outreach, it sounds like we are tackling some of the same issues as some of the other committees when it talks about having the information, having the services available to the community, and the community not knowing about them. So that education outreach was something really big. The active lifestyle, some of the strategies under that, we talked about the safe streets, the stray dogs, the parks and all of that. The next one is healthy foods, having access. We talked about the food deserts and the Brandy Market and some of those other strategies that we already have in place and some we can also implement. And then again, some of those, the crossover with the transportation, just having access to the providers. So that is what, those are the four that we have so far, and I'll let Miriam go ahead and fill in a little more details on the strategies.
So we've looked at the Tarrant County Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance that was done in 2015 to find out statistically what were our disparities. So we looked at those, by zip codes, and so then we worked with Tarrant County and their epidemiologists to kind of work down what are the top five that were prevalent in those zip codes. And so we kind of matched those and looked at the social determinants of health and put those strategies, and that's how we came up with those areas that will, so some of them are high blood pressure, obesity, diabetes, infermortality, cognitive decline,
goes to waste. So we go hunt for kids in right here in Riverside, hey, let's go to the center. Even if you didn't pay your $200-something, you can still go, so.
That's what we addressed, having programs like that, but the community not knowing they're available.
Yeah, it's there.
It's led to thinking that, oh, I don't have a membership at this Doc Sessions Community Center, so I can't even go. So again, it is not being communicated. It goes back to the outreach and the PR to say, guess what? You don't have to be a part. If you just are hungry, come during these times to get something to eat, and you don't have to participate in activities. We know it's there. We know the services are there. It's not being communicated, and that's the strategy that we're going to address.
We do it at Doc Sessions. We made some flyers and put on people's houses. You can come. Just show up. You're between this age and this age. Come. And your children can be fed.
Just to tack, piggyback on that, because we did talk a lot about the strategy about, you know, even because we did put a lot on the community engagement team, especially in this committee, but we also talked about utilizing neighborhood and community leaders to get that information out. We talked about how, and just to be clear, I have seen a lot of that the summer food program being promoted by the city, but I've seen it in channels like emails and online and things. So one of the strategies that fall under some of that education outreach is actually having the community engagement office work with specific neighborhood association community leaders to help get the word out in the right channels. Like you said, you made flyers aimed to Vermont's residents. And so when we talked about how each neighborhood is kind of unique and that different marketing channels work for different neighborhoods.
We passed out flyers last day of school at Mercy Williams to parents. Here you go. You can come and eat.
Well, I'd actually almost piggyback on what you're saying, Roxanne. Almost every neighborhood needs all the channels. So I'm a small neighborhood, and whatever we're doing, it's yard signs, it's door-to-door flyers, it's emails, it's next door, it's our Facebook, it's everything, which is exhausting for the neighborhood leaders because we're volunteers and doing this in addition to other things. So that's, I think, one of the challenges with all of the things I'm hearing so far is that awareness. How do you cut through the clutter? Because, again, some people, they'll tell us, I didn't get my email, I didn't get my flyer this month, or what have you. It's, if you don't, you think, well, you can maybe do one month, do the other, the next month. They're looking for their particular favorite communication.
I'd like to see something that challenges the city to do some type of incentive plan to get grocery stores. These food deserts are ridiculous. And it comes under health, I would imagine. That's where it comes under.
Even some mom and pop shops.
We talked about the food cart policy and relaxing some of those barriers to get in to be able to do the fresh fruit and vegetables so they can be in the neighborhoods and accessible. So we talked about some of those and how to restructure.
And Busan's was very supportive and was a leader in this, the food cart.
Sure. You raised the vote.
Yes, so they did relax some of those. So, I mean, that's a, we talked about, we're not going to start a side business, and we're going to get us a bus and refurbish it, and we're going to start our own. Yeah, so, but anyway, yes, we talked about that.
Entrepreneurship, yes. It falls into development.
We talked about having that. We talked about, you know, the situation where the grocery store in Forest Hill closed down, you know, and it was because of that. You know, so how do we encourage economic development? How do we encourage grocery stores to come into some of these zip codes when that is a deterrent? Right.
Any other
anything else on health? Okay, housing. Katie's not here. Is any Jennifer?
And I apologize. I'm reading and looking at some of our notes. Thanks to our support staff, Catherine. So the disparities that we're addressing is the fact that racial segregation in housing has increased in Fort Worth since 2010. 45% of African American households are rent burdened. In other words, they pay over 30% of their income for housing compared to 33% of all Fort Worth households, which is right around the percentage for folks to be paying. Hispanics comprise 59% of the households that are living in substandard housing or overcrowded. So one of the strategies, as you see on your sheet, that we're talking about is affordable housing incentives policy, because one of the things that we're seeing as we talk is the market forces are such that the developers, the builders, et cetera, don't have to. There's not a demand, so to speak. There's plenty of demand for the 200,000, 300,000 and up. And so how do we incentivize? So we're coming up, we're talking about strategies and policies that would promote fair housing even more for the minority populations that are disproportionately low income. Looking at populations, wide variety of populations in need, persons with disabilities, senior citizens, homeless or formerly homeless, Fort Worth Housing Solutions clients, single parents with children, et cetera. And we're saying that from so far what we're looking at is it wouldn't have a direct or immediate budgetary impact because we'd be targeting existing incentive activities to contribute to addressing these disparities that are currently caused by our local housing market. Let me get to the next recommendation. Around the home buyer assistance, so we have one, as many of you may or may not know, again, an awareness challenge. But again, very competitive market that we're in right now, so providing additional assistance and or removing administrative and procedural barriers to home ownership for low-income families of color. Again, promoting fair housing by increasing the opportunities for folks to become home buyers, which has been very, very challenging, even for folks of means to try to get housing in certain areas and whatnot. So many of you have seen all the different reports and news articles about how competitive Fort Worth and Tarrant County as a whole is, what the going rate is, like just over $1,000 a month. It's a market rate for a two-bedroom, one-bath apartment. So when you think back to some of when maybe your apartment days and what that looks like and translates to in today's dollars and with today's salaries, it's a challenge. Lastly, again, as a common theme, I think for all of our committees so far this evening is talking about awareness of what the actual resources are that are available. So again, more neighborhood-based workshops. To help increase the capacity, as we said in my earlier disparities, we've gone backwards in the last 8 years, not forwards. Again, around how do residents improve their own neighborhoods, which I think will also help balance some of those concerns a lot of neighborhoods are having around gentrification. So instead of the gentrification happening to neighborhoods, happening with neighborhoods. When I say that, it means a workshop I attended earlier this year. When you involve the neighborhoods that are being redeveloped, revitalized, then they're able to stay in those areas. They're able to benefit from the new amenities and things that are being brought to their neighborhoods and communities, and in some sense being rewarded for sticking it out those years, for being in those neighborhoods that were less desirable, that are now more so desirable. Helping, you know, having the city help with information and programs around home repair, counseling, financial literacy, code compliance. Again, I know some of these things are things that are already being done, but how do you amp it up? How do you get it more even targeted to the communities that need them so that we can turn that number around? Again, making sure that, particularly in the central city areas, that citizens are aware of all the housing-related programs that are available to support a better quality of life for our community.
I'm a little concerned about a couple of things, Jennifer. That is that if you look at the paper this morning, they were talking about the size of houses that are being built. I know that in the Stop 6 area in particular, you know, they're going for the higher end houses. I talked to Gina Bivens about it the other day. Was there any discussion at all about building smaller houses so people can get out of the privates,
right,
and have more independence? And there's something about tiny houses. Mm-hmm. I don't buy the tiny house thing, but right, but you could build a thousand square foot at $50 maybe a square foot building. You got a $50,000 building,
right?
And you could, and if it's 1,000 square feet, you can put somebody in that. You know, it's a whole different lifestyle once you get out of those apartments. Any discussion about tiny houses or smaller houses?
Well, tiny houses not directly as it relates to this committee. I've been involved in other kind of side conversations and community discussions around that. And what we've told some of the kind of community groups or individuals that are interested in that is bring something forward, bring a good project, well-thought project forward to most likely the Zoning Commission, and or potentially depending on how it's structured, city plan commission. Rather than the city trying to come up with policy, regulation, zoning ordinances that would meet that, bring good projects that we can evaluate that then the various bodies can make decisions on. One of the things to your point, I think that we're seeing more and more is as people coming back to urban living, there is some demand, I think, for smaller homes. That's also part of why you see some of the older neighborhoods that do have smaller homes either being revitalized or folks moving back into. I know my neighborhood, for example, most of the houses were built, they were about 1,600 square feet or smaller. You know, my families were still bigger, but living in smaller areas, and now the average size has gone up. But a lot of people are starting to want that closeness, want that proximity, and also not spend so much time on yard work, not spend so much time cleaning your home, utilities are less, all those things. So again, that would need to go into our incentive policy, I think, because right now the market forces aren't supporting it enough. You have pockets, so maybe in near south side, there's some talk around that. You see that with some of the auxiliary, whether it's the mother-in-law home type suites or second, the garage apartment type things, but we don't have a bigger area of that, because then still you tend to, the developers, you know, are looking to maximize their margins. So that's what we have to push for some of that as well, because just as I think we need diversity when it comes to representation, we need diversity of jobs, we need diversity of education opportunities, diversity of housing opportunities, because not everybody wants to live in a 3,000 square foot home.
Do you want to talk about some of the city and communicating which areas are NEZ zone, neighborhood empowerment zone, some of the fees that are for that are being foregoed, things like that?
We didn't get into that as specific with our discussions, but we have in some of our earlier meetings, you know, where kind of the overlay of what's available here, here, and here, and how do you bring those different resources together.
Some of our seniors are worried about, you know, in our neighborhood, right at the corner, there's 63 townhomes. Well, there'll be 10 that are 200,000, the other 53 will be 400,000. But they're worried about, well, my taxes and things like that. So we're telling them, hey, the city is the city communicating that if you make certain improvements, even if you're not 65, you can increase your taxes for 10 years. Does that type of information get out? Because that's an incentive to make your house nicer and you can stop your tax rate for 10 years, regardless of your home.
That goes back to what I was saying, is those that want to stay in the areas they're in and benefit to be able to have that opportunity. So just
know,
like,
what's out there.
Know what's out there to be able to stay put and not be forced out.
Yeah, just one quick note on that. Ms. Allen Gray did a good job. Some of the development in her area, this revitalization and all that's real good, it's real fine. But she really fought hard for the people in her district. But some of those houses were just gonna be too expensive. And I just, in Stock 6 right now is going through the whole revitalization things, and it's in the name, so. But I don't wanna force all those people out with homes that are just gonna be too expensive. So make sure that our recommendation has to be something to the city, that it has to be these homes.
Yeah,
yeah,
I agree.
Because you see that in the Linwood addition.
That's probably a test case.
Like Ms. Biggins said, the article in the paper, this on the newspaper, showed that they are putting smaller homes with larger homes in a new development, which, hey, it's going to be a mixed use of income and houses. So I thought that was a good idea.
Yeah, there's a Mount Pleasant in Cleveland, Ohio that had done that. They took a distressed area that had been burnt down from the riots and revitalized that. When we went and saw it in the early 2000s, it was a bank opening up. It was the first bank since the 1960s being opened in that area. But it had mixed use housing from low income to mid to high income, all working together.
And I mean, that's what we need to see more of forward, based on not only the current workforce, but
and you're bringing something forward. You're bringing something forward, a recommendation.
Yes, I think that'll be part of our end results. And so we're not scheduled to meet just yet, but Katie's been traveling, and so I know we're mindful of our deadline, so we're going to get it on the books soon.
Any questions? Transportation. We are meeting this Thursday, but you'll notice our strategies, our street improvements. We are looking at, one of the things I think we're going to be looking at, because I'll put words in everybody's mouth, Judy and Jennifer, because I had my first transportation meeting with the group about a month ago, and we've got a strategy of coming up to August the 3rd. But looking at street improvements, we need to look at all the bonds, packages that have been passed and what improvements have been that were approved in those bond packages, and how the city's going to prioritize that. Because if we improve our streets with sidewalks and lighting in our, you know, minority communities, that'll help our communities strive a little bit more. So we've got to take a look at that. Multimodal transportation, because on here, our disparities talked about automobile ownership, transit ridership. You know, transit is changing, and one of the things that we need to stop just looking at is just bus service. We've got to start looking at multimodal service and look at a transit system, not just a bus system, because we still have to get people from the first mile to the last mile. We can take a bus and take people to Alliance, but then again, once we drop them off, we still have to get them to their place of, you know, of work. So we've got to start looking at things as a whole vision for transportation, and that's something that we'll be talking about in our transportation committee there. But we also have to look at funding, good, bad, or different. Trinity Metro only gets a half cent sales tax. You know, when you look at what DART has done in Dallas, they get paid 1 cent from 12 municipalities. The Trinity Metro only gets it from City of Fort Worth, North Richland Hills, used to be Richland Hills, I don't think they do that anymore, but it's very limited of where their funding is coming from. So we will be asking maybe to look at what Tarrant County can contribute and other municipalities, because what we're seeing now here in the City of Fort Worth will start happening in other municipalities or suburbs. Because I remember when I was president of the chamber, Northeast Fort Worth called me because of education. The minorities that were going in, Hershey, Bedford, North Richland Hills, and so forth, and having to work with them to get them, you know, up to par as far as their education and getting them to come out and be active community individuals with the ISD. That growth in those areas are growing too, the minorities, the blacks, the Hispanics, the Asians, and Muslims, and so forth. So we've got to look at this as a Tarrant County, you know, solution when we look at transit, because we've got to put everybody to wherever they can be, whether it's in Southeast Fort Worth, it's West Fort Worth, Northeast Fort Worth, but we've got to give them jobs. That's number one. But we also, one of the things that we've got to look at is transportation. Transportation is changing a lot. So when you look at workforce, you know, it's not going to just be a bus driver, you know. Technology will change the way transportation is going to be in the next 5-10 years. And we've got to make sure that we have the skilled workforce to support that, whatever those, you know, mechanisms are going to be, whether they're going to be autonomous vehicles and so forth. Pedestrian safety, you know, we have a lot of people riding bikes, especially in the urban inner cities areas, but we also have to make sure, because one of the things that we found out is the crashes that are taking place in various bike crashes. You know, we've got to start looking at, are these places lit? Are they properly marked for bikes? Do they have sidewalks? Do they have a, you know, lane directly or specific managed lanes for bikes, you know, so that there's not as many crash victims, because apparently there was 86% of fatal bike crashes, and we need to stop that for sure. Our meeting is going to be this Thursday, so we'll start diving more and more into the recommendations that we're going to be looking at to recommend, but we are very mindful of our timeline, and we've worked from August 3rd backwards, so as stated a minute ago, our first meeting is going to be this Thursday. Judy, Jennifer, do you have anything to add?
No, I think you covered. I mean, the main thing, like you said, around the bond, especially the street improvements, and that fair grade on the street conditions.
Exactly.
And what happens when they get into port, how long do they stay for, and what other things happen around them.
Right.
Any discussion about the employers taking ownership in some of this? You get them out to Alliance, and then now what?
I know that even Alliance is talking about that as well.
getting the employers to make a commitment.
Well, and I know early on we applauded the Tarrant County College's efforts as far as what they're doing with the students now. I think it's already in effect.
It's in effect.
Basically, can use their badge, their ID, student ID, and use the Trinity Metro.
Speaking of transportation, you know, Fort Worth missed the boat a long time ago when Dallas was creating DART.
You got to stop and take a half a cent versus a cent.
No, we missed the boat when DART was created. Fort Worth was like this. In Tarrant County, look where DART is today. Are you all going to be talking to the federal government? Because I remember, and I think there may have been some hesitation, because I don't remember, but I read that when DFW Airport was created, Fort Worth had just built an airfield brand new, and it ended up closing within 10 years because they built DFW. Well, that was the federal government saying, okay, stop. This is a big area, we're going to do one airport. You all talked to city talking and Tarrant County talking to the federal government about mass transportation for this entire area? How do we connect with DART? That's my point.
Right now you have the TexRail that does connect to DART. DART and Trinity Metro run that to go from, you know, downtown Fort Worth all the way out to Dallas. There's also another TexRail. Well, that's Trinity Metro. I'm sorry, Trinity Metro. The TexRail project will go out to DFW Airport, and then they can connect from there also to DART. But there is, Fort Worth is behind in transportation. We are very behind in it. But again, it goes back to money. And yes, there's funding out there, but you also have to look at every city, major city in this U.S. is going after that funding. And we've got to come up together to find out how we're going to get not only our local, but our state and our federal officials to start working to look for funding mechanisms. And it may not always be government. It could be private money that's going to come in to help.
Well, private and government money. So Kate Granger would be a good place to start, because that project around the river looked really, really nice, and that was envisioned by her, and we want this, and it's happening. So I think Fort Worth needs to get on the ball about transportation.
Well, there has been a committee that's been put together to start looking at transit, not only in Fort Worth, but throughout Tarrant County, and start looking at that because they understand that they're behind.
Specifically, are you recommending, or do you think you'll recommend, how you raise that half cent to 1 cent sales tax?
We can make some recommendations, but it's going to have, again, we haven't discussed that. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I mean, do you think you will?
I think we'll find whatever recommendations that we can that can be supportive. But again, it's going to go back to the different municipalities to be able to get funding.
No, I'm talking about Fort Worth only right now.
Well, there is some ways, but I don't want to mention those ways until
let us meet again on Thursday.
We're going to talk on Thursday, and that's when we'll be able to come up with some
solutions. I think we can consider talking about whether or not you take part of the money for crime and put it in transportation.
It's going to be reallocated to get there, right? Is that what you're saying?
This is a very timely discussion. Ms. Navajar has not disclosed that she is actually involved in multiple committees that are dealing with these issues, including the Chamber Transportation Committee and a special group that's going to be overseeing an update of the transit master plan. Trying to find the right way to phrase it. The politics are heavy.
Yes.
There are 100 reasons why nothing will work. But it will take bold moves and leadership by groups like this task force to move this discussion forward. And so I can tell you that if this task force were to take a firm position that makes sense, that's feasible, that it will be heard. And it will make an impact.
I think we should give, when we do our final recommendation that we all agree upon, we should send a pair of Nike tennis shoes to every city councilman. Because because their motto is just do it. It's fine.
All right.
Their motto is run away.
Exactly. Anyway, we will have more at the next meeting to talk about. As stated, we are meeting this Thursday, and that is something that we're going to be doing, is looking out of the box and looking at what other communities are doing, because there's a lot of best practices out there in the U.S. That have created the multimodal systems that we need today.
It's exciting.
Yes. And Charles, what's your report on governance?
We need it.
Just thought I'd ask. Okay, I didn't want you to be left out. Michelle, next is discussion on arrangements of open house meetings.
So once the recommendations are put together, we want to do another public outreach to residents so that they can see the recommendations and they can provide their feedback. So it was suggested, we talked about it in our co-chairs meeting, about doing a kind of an open house format. And so what would happen is people would come in, we would have a table for each of the committees that would be staffed by committee members and staff, and people would get a copy of the recommendations, and then they would be able to come and ask questions of people at the tables and provide their comments. We would also have an overview of what the task force has done so far in the form of a video and a short presentation. And we're looking at having them in the evenings from 6 to 8. I'll pass around, we have 5 scheduled so far. Our original thought was to do 4. The co-chair suggested that we add a 5th one in Diamond Hill on the near north side. So I've got that one added. I just got the date confirmed, which is October 8th for that one, if you want to write that in. When I mapped them, I noticed that there wasn't anything on the kind of far east side. So I have down here as a possible 6th, the East Regional Library. We had a really good turnout when we've done community conversations there. It was probably our largest group. I think we had almost 80 people when we did the conversation there. So I thought that might be a good location to hit that east side. So we tried to spread them out geographically. We have a mix of churches, city facilities, and if anybody has any comments or suggestions, be happy to hear them.
I'd just like to see the meeting on the east side.
You want them on the east side? Well, when I mapped it, I knew that the east side needed to be.
One of the things I would say, I know you probably cannot make every one of these meetings, but as many of them that you can make, that would be great to be able to be there at the table to talk about and answer any questions.
And I'll send out meeting invites to all of these so that you can get them on your calendar.
All right. Any questions of Michelle? As you will see, we meet again on August 20th, and that's when we will be presenting our draft recommendations to the Forge Task Force. So I'm sure that evening we will have a long meeting, so be prepared so that we can make sure that we answer any and all concerns, questions, and so forth, because we want to make sure that we dot our I's and cross our T's before we go out to the public.